Okay, it's Professor John Cook from Herkimer County Community College, and he's going to talk about exploring embedded system vulnerabilities.
Hi, everybody. Like Ronnie said, my name is John Cook, and I'm here from Herkimer College. I'm going to talk to you today about embedded systems. Some of the stuff you're going to know about, and some of it hopefully you won't. But we're going to take a look at some things. I haven't really had a chance to look around. I apologize if I look like I'm looking for people, but there's a lot of people I know. I really appreciate the work these guys have done putting this project together, getting everybody here. It's a lot of hard work, and we really appreciate it.
Yeah, I know.
Not nearly as much as you guys have. So, what are we talking about today? A lot of you are familiar with embedded systems. You know, a lot of times we take for granted the things we have around us, but even something simple like an Amazon Fire Stick, right? When we look at things like our cell phones, it's a lot different today than it used to be. It used to be we'd buy a device, it would be very special purpose, it would do one thing, it would normally have an ASIC in it, an application-specific integrated circuit, it would do one thing really well. But today, computing technology has gotten so cheap that most of these devices now actually have computers in them. They run operating systems. They do all kinds of things. So we'll take a look at that here in just a second. But just to make sure we're all on the same page, just think about some of the things that we're going to talk about. Cable TV boxes, ATM machines, right? All types of things that we look at out there. Why would we want to explore these embedded systems? Obviously, this really applies to you guys. A lot of you are still in school. You're learning about things. There's a lot of things you can learn from taking a look at some of these embedded systems, the way they go about doing things. I like what the previous presenter was talking about when we talked about people being tinkerers. I'm sure a lot of you consider yourself tinkerers, and this certainly can fall into that category. Another thing that we often do with embedded devices is we want to change the platform on it. We might want to emulate. You know, a lot of people have used things like any of the Game Boys, any of the Nintendo stuff. You run an emulator, you can run that information. A lot of that has come from the type of things that we talked about here today. Repairing different types of devices. Give you an opportunity to get in there. And if you know how it works, you can often not only break it, but fix it. Repurposing devices, enhancing capabilities. And certainly a lot of things we're talking about here today in relationship to security. So, I know that some of you are just getting started in your educational career, some of you have been here for a while, but regardless of the level that you're at, it does take some fundamentals of some different areas. We talk about networking, we talk about computer hardware, you know, understanding connectivity with things like serial connections, USB. Some of you have done a lot of this stuff already and may not even realize it. How many people have ever accessed a Cisco router at the command line? Right? Most times you go through the console port, even though, yeah, you think it's funny, but there's some people here that have it. But that connection goes through an RJ45, but really over that connection is the serial connection. So, some other things that many of you have done, HTML, Python, JavaScript, basic electricity and electronics. And even if you don't have all these skills, a lot of these things you can learn as you go. So you get an opportunity to play with some of this stuff. Some of you may want to go a little bit more advanced, and eventually some of you will be exploring executables. That takes a lot of schooling. Obviously, it takes somebody who knows a lot about computer science, somebody who's studied in programming, and then they go a little bit further than that. I know a lot of programmers have been programming all their life, but they still don't know how to take executables and decompile them using something like IDAPRO. It's kind of a specialized thing, but a lot of you might end up going into that area. So, how do we do this? How do we go about doing something like this? Whether we have something like this NAS here that I have, I brought this NAS. This would be considered an embedded device. A lot of times, the first thing you do is explore or exploit existing interfaces. How do you go about doing that? Well, you may have heard the term fuzzing before. Everybody see that back there? So, fuzzing, what is fuzzing? Fuzzing is when we throw unexpected data to an interface, whether it's typing on a keyboard, whether it's sending some API or some physical interface information that it might not necessarily expect to see what happens. Sometimes you get a result that you don't want to see. Perhaps you have a device on your network and you throw a bunch of data at it and it locks up or it reboots. Even that is valid, finding out how to break something. Hidden menus. We see a lot of times where manufacturers have installed backdoors or hidden menus into things. You might find those. You might Google about a device on the internet and find some backdoor that you can get in. Another thing that was interesting a few years back, this is quite a few years now, but I thought it was a great example, is that the old Xbox One, early on, again, the Xbox One was a great and earth-shattering gaming machine that Microsoft came up with. But of course, immediately people wanted to dig into it, take it apart. If you notice that controller there on the left has a standard USB flash stick plugged into it. How are they able to do that? You'd think it would be something really difficult. You'd need a degree in electrical engineering to figure that out. But people started to look at what the interface really was, and they found out that the Xbox, even though it's a non-standard connector, the standard Xbox connector is actually nothing more than USB in a different connector. So they stripped the wires away, connected some USB stuff to it, and said, ooh, this is interesting. And in fact, if you plug a memory stick directly into an Xbox, it recognizes it and asks if you want to format it, which of course opens up a whole world of having the ability to either push code in or take things off of an Xbox. What about changing or modifying the configuration in existing devices? Many of you are probably familiar with VoIP technology. We hear about the Vonage commercials all the time on TV. Those VoIP boxes often reach out to the internet, and in fact with Vonage, they reach out to the internet and pull their configuration file down. If it can pull it down, oftentimes you can too. Once you pull that configuration file down, you can take that configuration file, rework it to the way you want it to be, and then send that to the device. Now you, again, repurpose the device to something that maybe it wasn't originally intended to do. There are a number of different devices like that. Cable modems, for example, are something that do the same thing. When they boot, they do DHCP, they get their next server value, they reach out to that TFTP server, pull the configuration file down, and that's how they know how to run, including their QoS values. Many devices have internal hardware interfaces that you're not even aware of. This is an example, probably one of the most ubiquitous routers out there, the WRT54G. This one was actually dead, and it actually belonged to a friend of mine, so I brought it, and I started playing around with it, and I said, well, can't make it any worse. Tore it apart, took a look at the circuit board, and there were a few unpopulated headers, and these were also unpopulated originally, so I went ahead and soldered some pins in there, hooked up my little serial adapter, and lo and behold, wouldn't you know, that serial adapter was actually tied as TTYS0 to the kernel as it booted. So you could actually watch it as it booted up, and it turns out that the actual kernel image in there, it started to load, the bootloader would load up, but it wouldn't load. So they actually had a routine built in there during manufacturing time that allowed you to upload the firmware from the command line. So I TFTP'd the new firmware up to it, and boom, it came right back up again. Hence it got the smiley face sticker. So a lot of the devices have internal interfaces, but some of them you're familiar with, like the serial interface that you've used before, perhaps. Other ones, maybe not so much. JTAG, the Joint Test Aperture Group, and also the SDI interfaces. And I got a great example. Anybody here work for Cisco by any chance? Okay, so we'll get to that in just a second. So I have a number of interfaces that I've either purchased or acquired somewhere or another over the years. The one on the top left here is called a Black Flash USB. And that has SDI capability, it has JTAG capability, and it's all through USB. So what that allows you to do is to either pull information directly off the chips or interface interactively with perhaps a geotech board. Depending on the device, some of them are interactive, some of them aren't so much. So next to that little clip, we'll talk about that here in a little bit. The interface on the right is a serial interface that does 3.3 and 5 volt. Some interfaces are 3.3 and some are 5, and you have to pick the appropriate one. That one I just happened to get with another piece of equipment that I had ordered one time, but I've used it for many, many, many things since. And if you don't have a lot of money, again, I understand when you're playing around with these things, you know, for a couple of bucks, you can go out and get a USB direct to serial with just the four pins, and they're kind of there, and it's great for research and development and messing around with these different devices if you want to play around with it. You can pick those up on eBay for $3-4. So, like I said, some devices, you go in there, you find some pins, you connect to serial, you interact with them, you can see what's going on. Other devices, not so much. So again, since nobody works for Cisco, let's take a look at this Cisco DTA. This is a digital terminal adapter. This is your new cable box that they have out there. And I pulled the cover off and took a picture of it for you just to show you, and I know that's kind of hard to read. So underneath that little foil shield there, there's some RAM. And then we have NVRAM over here, and we have a processor. So really, this is nothing unlike a normal computer that you might interface with. Unfortunately, this isn't something you can go out and download the firmware for, right? They do it over the air. They do it actually, I should say over the air, over the cable wire, and the F connector coming through the RF, it updates the firmware. So there really is no firmware. So if you want to explore it, it's not like you go out and down to Cisco's website and pull the firmware down. Well, unfortunately, that little clip that I had that you can purchase, if you look up the data sheets for the different chips, it shows you the pinouts, it tells you what they are. And in fact, this chip turned out to be a WinBond that uses an SPI interface. So we clip onto the chip, don't power the device up, power the chip from the clip, and actually extract the firmware directly from the chip without affecting the device in any way. So again, that was one of those non-interactive interfaces with a device that we don't know a lot about. I'm just curious. I don't know a lot about that device. I want to know what's going on inside. Maybe I can pull that firmware and emulate it somewhere. Maybe I can pull that firmware and see what it does. So, again, when we want to explore this firmware, though, what are we doing? Well, again, I remind you that a lot of these embedded devices are nothing more than single-board computers. The interesting thing about these single-board computers is they run operating systems that we're familiar with. Linux or Windows? Not really a whole lot of choices out there. Which one do you think they use more? Why? Free. Exactly. So what does this have to do with the firmware itself, though, just because of the device? Well, you're familiar with firmware when you some of you have upgraded your motherboards before. You go out and you download the firmware and you upgrade it. Well, that's the BIOS. That's not really the computer itself. But these embedded devices, the firmware is the operating system very often. It's not just a little piece of code or minor changes or a configuration file. It is the operating system. So what's in that file? That single binary that you download often contains the kernel, a bootloader. Some of them don't, but most often it is. It's the bootloader, the kernel, and the OS hierarchy in the files. All putting that one single file for us. So how do they make it into that single file? Well, it's kind of like TAR. They use CRANFS, they use SquashFS, but in either case, it doesn't really matter because now that we have that file, we really have the code that runs on that device, and subsequently, we can take a look at it. So how do we extract that? We have a wonderful utility called BinWalk. BinWalk has the capability of taking these firmware files and it can effectively unsquash them. Now, BinWalk is very extensible. It has different plugins, different capabilities, and I'm going to run it here in just a couple of minutes so you can see just exactly how it works. But generally, when you use BinWalk, you're trying to do something one way. But again, depending on what you're trying to do, and certainly if you're getting started in this and you want to try it out, Nothing wrong with downloading Binwalk, getting it installed, which is probably half the challenge, which is far more difficult than actually downloading a bin to some browser somewhere and extracting it. But Binwalk does it in a one-way fashion. It extracts it, you're left with the raw files, you can look at them, you can explore them. The firmware modification kit is kind of a fork of that. They use Binwalk, but as it's extracting the files, it actually creates a log and figures out how it was done so that you can actually put the firmware back together. Now, that might be handy if you want to do something like change some code, recompile it, and push that bin back on the device. So, oftentimes, that's the only way we can do it. Maybe we don't have a way to interface with the device any different. But again, for some of the things that you do, you don't even necessarily need to put the bin back on the device. Does this always work? No. It doesn't always work. You gotta remember, I'm talking about it today here in a public setting. I'm not the only one that knows about this. So sometimes they obfuscate it, sometimes they encrypt. Certainly on very, very secure devices, they encrypt the information, they encrypt the firmware. And again, that example I used earlier about the Xbox, they kind of knew that people were going to try to hack it. So they encrypted the information and they did some things with the hard drive. Well, some tinkerers decided that they wanted to figure out how to get into the box anyway. So what they did was they actually tapped traces on the boards of the Xboxes and intercepted the encryption key on the fly. Then they took that encryption key, decrypted it, and they got into it anyway. So I've got these firmwares, and the one that I talked about earlier is on here, and I also have the firmware for this Seagate, and I also had a firmware that I just happened to have from a TP-Link router. So just to give you an idea, I kind of wanted to grab a broad cross-section of different types of firmware that you might encounter. So I got a router, I got a network-attached storage, and I got that Cisco DTA, which this is the actual image that I pulled from that chip. So let's do the Cisco DTA first. So I named it WinBond W25Q64. Anybody know why? That's the name of the chip. That's the stamp that's on the chip. That's actually the SPI. It's an 8 meg SPI memory storage device. So I'm just going to go ahead and show you briefly here how you would do something like this. So I'm just going to run Binwalk with a dash E to extract. Well, it actually did fail in a couple of them because they didn't have a couple of extractors installed. Well, let's see what it did find. So now if I do an ls, I can see that I have a new folder called with a different extension on it with an underscore in front of it. And if I do an ls in that folder, you can see that it pulled apart a bunch of things, and you can see that some of them didn't get completely extracted, but there is something that does look quite curious, and that is the one that says squash fs-root. So if we take a look at that, anything look familiar there to anybody? Now remember, this was from a cable box, and I just pulled the firmware off the chip. There was no way of really knowing what was on there. And of course, we could work on this for hours now, right? So we're not even going to get into its grips and look at it and see what was going on. So what might I do with something like that at this point? Well, I might try to emulate it. I might want to see what it is. I might want to see what type of hardware it recognizes. I might look at what modules are in there, so on and so forth. The sky's the limit. But for the sake of time, I'm not going to really go into the TP-Link one, although it's there. You can see the firmware, and it looks significantly similar to what that is. But the one I really want to look at is the Seagate NAS firmware. Now, this is the actual firmware image that's installed on this Seagate NAS right now. I already decompressed it. You can see, obviously, again, we see something that looks very familiar to us. So one of the first things I did was I said, well, geez, I wonder what kind of web backend we got on this. And again, for the sake of time, I'm just going to jump to the folder where the web interface is. I'm just going to break it up so everybody can see that. And basically, this is the root of the web server because there's a web interface that we can get into on this. So let me just show you real quick the web interface. And the default username, of course, the typical admin on this one. Okay. So, and of course, I perused the web pages and looked around, saw what was there, and I said, well, I see some PHP. Of course, the most interesting folder I saw right away was admin, right? I mean, you see an admin folder under that web echelon, it's like, ooh, yeah, I want to look in there. So I started looking in there, and there's a lot of DHP, a lot of includes, a lot of code there. Okay, this is interesting. Well, I wonder if any of this PHP does calls to bash shells. And how do we do that? About exec or system, right, if we want to send something to bash. So I'll just grep for exec in every file. And in fact, if we look, we can see that there's a lot of PHP code that's calling to the bash shell and running different things. So then I thought, well, I wonder if any of them take variables that you type in from the web pages, perhaps on a submit or something like that. So again, for sake of time, I guess I should have taken your advice. Okay, finally, there we go. Okay, so this is one of the PHP files that's on there, and I apologize for the blue, I know that's really hard to read, but if you look at what's there, by the way, in the blue up top, it tells that, you know, this was done, copyright 2009, Wistron Corporation. Now remember, this is a Seagate. Did a little more research and found out that at the end of the day, this firmware actually runs on Western Digital NAS as well. So I thought that was kind of interesting, but what I was looking for, this is one of the files that showed up when I did that grep. And immediately I noticed that here's the exec, it says grep-i $IP address. Well, $IP address is actually a get variable that gets pulled in. If you look, right here it says IP address equals get IP. And if you've done any PHP at all, you know that that's just an argument that gets pushed from the URL. So now I have a way that I might be able to throw something at this and do some quote unquote command injection. But what command injection am I going to do? Well, again, I started to look at, well, and here are all the utilities that are running on this or can run on this. And I was looking for SSH, right? So I could SSH into it. If I get SSH running, wouldn't it be great? I could admin and see if I could get in there at least at the command line. I'd see telnet D, that wouldn't be a bad idea. And from the command line, if I open up the command line here, well, maybe telnet's running. Nope, failed there. Why did they leave that on there? No SSH running, but I don't see SSHD there. Or do I? Could do an NNAP. But a lot of people aren't familiar, and for a long time I wasn't either. SSH, the open SSH, SSHD, isn't the only game in town. There are actually a lot of mini SSH servers out there. One of them is called DropBear. So again, to save us a little time, I actually have that URL here. And if we take a look at that code real quick, again, we were looking for a variable called IP. And that IP variable was pushed into a grep, so it's looking for a second argument for grep. So I'm going to give it the argument it wants, and I just threw a number in there. And of course, in Bash, we know that we can append another command by hitting semicolon. So what do you think we want to add here? How about user-sbin/? Uh-oh, nothing happened. And of course, we already know that we're in. And of course, to finish up, I could go back and pipe a password into password for. Oh, and incidentally, this is where it gets really interesting. They broke a couple of rules here, right? The rules that we talk about. Let's see, how about. What privileges are the web server running at?
Oh, nice.
Now, I know some of you are familiar with this stuff, but when you start looking at this firmware, it is inconceivable how many holes there are in it. There's actually a URL that's like a big random string, but it's not so random because if you go in there and you look at it, it's actually a diagnostic that you can't get to from any clickable menu, but if you know it's there, that URL, if you go to it, you can turn diagnostics on, and you can also turn telnet D on. And of course, then you can get it as admin. And if you look at this code, like we did, we submitted and we got DropBear running. But now we could just as easily change the root password to whatever we want, and we're in, and we don't. Does anybody have any questions?
We can make it available.
Obviously, the interactive part, you're not going to see it. But again, just remember that. Binwalk. And grab a piece of firmware and try it. What's the worst that can happen? It doesn't extract. So again, binwalk-e, grab your favorite firmware from your router that you have, or whatever, or download one off the internet, and take a look at it. You'll be surprised at what you can find by exploring some of those firmwares. Anything else?
Thank you, Chuck.